We're here tonight to talk about a master plan for downtown North and downtown West. Obviously, this is a topic of great interest and great potential. This is a terrific opportunity for Hartford. And how often does a city like Hartford or any city have the opportunity to develop a piece of land or many pieces of land that amount to so many acres? I'm not sure how many acres it is. I've seen 40, I've seen 120, but it's a lot of land. So it's a terrific opportunity for the city. And as a center for civic engagement, the library is delighted to be partnering with the City of Hartford's Development Services Department to present this program tonight. Before we get started, I do just want to mention a couple of the other great things that are going on here at the library. They're on the table in the back. There are some flyers and announcements about various things going on here. I hope some of you saw them, or we'll take a look later on. Our winter calendar is back there. Friday night of this week, Friday the 13th, I believe, we have our new art show opening on the third floor of the Art Walk. The artist for this show is David Borowski, and it's a really terrific, unique show. I hope you'll join us for that opening. And the next day, on Saturday, we are collaborating with Real Artways to do a community conversation called How Our Surroundings Shape Us. And this is a really interesting experiment. We're using an art exhibit, which is up at Real Artways, as the starting point for a community conversation to get to community issues. So I hope some of you will join us on Saturday over there. And also our jazz series, which is very popular, is starting up again January 5th. It'll be every Sunday from January through the end of April. So, hope we see you at some of those happenings. And again, thank you for coming tonight. And now it's my pleasure to turn it over to Tom Deller from Development Services. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome. As Richard said, my name is Tom Deller. I'm the Director of Development Services for the city. And tonight is our last public discussion on Downtown North, the redevelopment plan. I got to keep my glasses on so I can read my notes here. The redevelopment plan for this area of the city. And I think it's important to talk a little bit about why this plan came about and what we're trying to achieve with this plan. This is a plan that's being funded by a Sustainable Communities grant. And the purpose of this grant and this study was to actually look at this area of the city, these areas of the city, and determine how we position them for growth and redevelopment in a sustainable way. How we think about how people can move, what kind of development can happen, what kind of density can we achieve? How do we connect the north end of the city back to downtown? How do we think about bridging 84? How do we change the nature of this area in a way that we realize that is realizable, something that can be that can happen, and maybe not all at once, but maybe over a period of time. And so the consultants for this team were charged with doing that analysis, but not only looking at what is potential development and what is the mass and scale, but to do some market analysis to understand what is happening economically in the city and in the region, to understand the mobility patterns of the people who move into Hartford County and move in between Hartford County from one city to the next. What are the type of people who are moving into the city? What kind of housing opportunities do we have or do we need to think about that we could create? And to try to get a better understanding of the market. Everything that's here is really being proposed in a sense as the maximum. You know, if you look at our zoning, a lot more is permitted than what's being proposed here. A lot more could theoretically happen, but we need to have some market reality in what we're trying to address here. We need to understand what we think might happen if the right variables were in place. And so that's what we're trying to achieve through this. So the presentation tonight is going to go through a series of scenarios, and I will say that some of these scenarios have been modified and changed based on the comments and discussion that we've had. We need to recognize that this is about preparing an area for development, and it's something that doesn't necessarily happen overnight. That we've thought about how something like this may be phased in and how it ties into other growth and development that's happening in the city and how it relates to the different neighborhoods. So we've spent a lot of time to try to think about the vision that was originally created in 2007 with the adoption of the redevelopment plan of what was trying to be achieved here. And we wanted to try to think about how we can refine that and how we can move it forward. And we wanted to try to create a plan that actually talks about what the city's expectations are for the development of this property. And we wanted to think about how we created a predictable and streamlined permitting process so that if a developer came in to develop something, we could achieve it. And one of the reasons we spent so much time looking at the market is to try to understand what is real, what we can really achieve. And we have to recognize that there are things that we might want to achieve that because of the expectations and desires of other communities that we may be in competition with some of them, we may not be able to achieve that. So there are lots of variables here, lots of different issues that have to be looked at. You know, people have asked us, what can the city do to really make this development happen? And that's one of the things that we are preparing some ideas that we will discuss with the mayor, and then we will take to the city council and say, these are things that we think we have to think about putting in place to help developers come forward and develop here. So we need to think about, is there some sort of incentive that we might offer, some sort of benefit that we might give a developer? Counter that, we also have to say to the developer, if we're going to do this for you, this is what we expect you to do for the city of Hartford. These are the community benefits that we expect to realize. And so we need to define some of those issues. In doing this study, we also have to recognize that the city doesn't own all of the land that we're studying. We own some of it. Others is owned by private individuals. We have met and talked with those individuals. We continue to discuss with those individuals. We may at some point say to them, we want to buy your property. They may say to us at some point that they want to buy ours. But this is an ongoing process, excuse me, and we're trying to set out the framework of how this moves forward. Planning can't be done in isolation. We have looked at the plans that are being done for Interstate 84. We understand what impact that may or may not have. You know, we've done a lot of analysis of the streets in the area. You know, we believe, from a planning point of view, that the streets are too wide and they're more designed for cars and not designed for the people who need to traverse from one area to the next. They're not pedestrian friendly. We need to think about them. You know, we need to think about what is the market. Now, there is a proposal in here that looks at commercial space. We hired a retail analyst to look at that and think about that. There is some proposal for office space, and one of the things we have to think about, is there an ability, given the surplus of office space in the city, to actually market potential office space? You know, we are in discussions with several businesses that would be moving potentially very large numbers of jobs into the city. If we are successful at achieving those negotiations, then maybe the answer is yes, but we need to understand it. So we look at, while we are talking about potential office space in this development, we're looking at what we have as a vacancy rate citywide. We're looking at what's happening and how the office market is changing and being shaped, and trying to understand what we can and can't achieve. This is a plan. This is not necessarily a new plan. This is building on all the plans that have been done in the past to try to refine and shape that vision. And I think lastly, one of the things that has been brought out in the past was, what about the XL Center? And I will say that a decision was made many years ago that the XL Center should be in downtown. And I think the city's view is that if we can keep it where it is and renovate it where it is, it would be far better for us to invest those dollars to maintain that facility and invigorate that facility than to move it. Because the businesses that are located in the downtown depend on that facility and depend on what's happening and going forward. There has been no study done at this point. There has been no analysis done. And that is something that has to be done. But if that analysis says it can't be built in place, well, then we're going to have to think of alternative locations, and there are possible alternatives. But we need to understand that if we move the XL Center, what are the negative impacts by creating a hole in the downtown, by leaving an existing building vacant, and how do we address that? So I give this long, rambling introduction to basically say that there have been lots of questions that have been raised over the last few months, and we have tried very hard to look at them and to address them. And one of the things I want to end with before I turn this over to consultants is to say that we did create, as part of this, a steering committee made up of local people, neighborhood people, to help us, guide us, and give us advice on this. And I really think that one of the things that happens is we don't often recognize those people at events like this. And before I turn this over to Tim Love, I thought it would be best to introduce those who are here and thank them for their work and for participation in this. So first, I want to thank Jennifer Cassidy of Asylum Hill NRZ. Jennifer, you can wave your hand so people know you're there. You're not usually that shy. Kelly Kirkley Bay of Clay Arsenal. Kelly's in the back. Mary Ellen Kolowski of the Capital Region Council of Government, our funding agent. There's Mary Ellen. Mike Freemuth of CRDA. I don't think Mike's here. I haven't seen him if he is. Oz Griebel of the Hartford Alliance, who is out of the country, lucky for him. We had Ron Angelo of DECD. He is not here this evening. Representatives Mike Zaleski of the BID. Mike's here somewhere. Where are you, Mike? In the back. Steve Bonifanti, the Redevelopment Agency, and David Blatt of Planning and Zoning. I saw you, David, and there's David. So that was our local steering committee. We tried to have involved and help us form this as we move forward. So with that, I think I'm going to turn this over to Tim Love of Utile to start going through this up-to-date presentation of where we are. Thank you.
This is our last public meeting. I think this is our third. Is that true, Tom? I think this is our third public meeting. I'm going to introduce the other members of the consultant team as we get to the topics, and that might be more relevant for you. We have quite a detailed agenda tonight. We want to walk through a couple of the topics that we looked at carefully. I know that a big contingent here is very interested in the open space planning and design chapter, which is number 4. So until we get there, you're going to get a comprehensive understanding of downtown and where the skate park fits into it. So hang in there. Hopefully, you can be agents for change even beyond the skate park when you leave. That's my goal tonight. So I'm going to talk first of all about I would say the impetus for the plan. I'm going to back up for a minute to say that our general goal. I'm an urban designer and an architect. I'm a physical designer first. That our primary goal was to hopefully 15, 20 years from now to make the walk from downtown to Albany Street be a consistent walkable blend. But as you walk from downtown up to the residential neighborhoods of North, there wouldn't be a sudden break with vacant lots and a bridge over a highway, but that the city would be a kind of continuous fabric. And so that has been our number one guiding principle for the development scenarios we looked at, for our recommended streetscape improvements and our open space improvements. So that hovers over the whole exercise. The question that Tom and his group asked, and I'll put it very simply, is if a developer comes to town and says, I want to develop here, what should I do and where should I go, is a very important question for a city, because a city can both channel public dollars for public improvements, open space, street improvements, but a city also needs to channel private investment so that each private development adds up to a cohesive neighborhood. And this is actually a bigger challenge for cities, which is to not say yes or no to developers, but maybe, but if you do what we think is the right thing to do here. And that's really the framework for the plan. So I'm going to start with the development scenarios, which is really how we started the project. Once we do that, at the same time that we were doing that, Kevin Hively, who's here, who's an economic development consultant, ran a parallel market analysis so that when we did these development scenarios and we provided data to Kevin about number of units and amount of retail, he could do a gut check whether the market said that what we were showing was actually feasible over a certain time period. And so we were running the numbers in parallel with the design. We're going to talk in some detail then about the streetscape improvements, which are as much about walkability as even making the streets work better as a connected network with the rest of the city. And finally, the open space ideas, which include ideas about improving the park where the skate park is going. It includes a couple of good ideas about making a stronger connection between downtown North and downtown West to get to the Riverfront Park too. That cage can't be the only way to get there, right? So That is also how we're going to get value back to this neighborhood. So those are the basic chapters. To planning and design, I think everybody here knows that the schools there, there's a great little retail strip there. There's some action happening back on this block. There's some development down the hill, but it's an area that's a little bit without character. Or it's an area that, as a physical place, doesn't have the most pleasant characteristics. And so what we did is that we looked carefully at this area to decide what building mix, what happens on the ground floor, the building heights would create the best blend between the downtown and the neighborhoods to the north. And that's really what we did. This is the larger scope of our planning study, which includes both everything to the Excel Center to the west to the train station, across 84, and then the whole riverfront park was part of our study area to figure out how that could tie into a story about downtown north. So just that was the scope. In terms of the funding that Tom got for our study, you submit a kind of funding application. That was the territory that the city was awarded planning dollars to do the plan. The first thing that we did, and we often do this with this kind of plan, which is a different kind of plan, because this is really an economic development plan, was to look at what we call the underutilized parcels, which tends to be surface parking lots, maybe a big lot with a small underutilized building on it, and also the city-owned property, and it's hard to see, I guess the color's a little bit washed out, to see that in the downtown north area, between the city-owned land and the vacant parcels, is actually quite a bit of land to think about collectively. And Tom mentioned that when we do this kind of planning, we both test scenarios on public parcels, but we also test scenarios on private parcels, especially if they're underdeveloped, because in a way that's good for the property owner. We're thinking through some visions maybe that those property owners didn't think about. And especially when city parcels are adjacent to private parcels, that could be a larger vision that might be a win-win for both parties. And so these are the areas that we decided to focus in on, both because of the ownership structure, but also because there were clues in the existing urban fabric around these parcels that helped point the direction of what we should do. Because again, this is a kind of fabric mending project where we don't want to reinvent, we're not going to plop down here a building from outer space. Again, the goal is to look carefully at the existing buildings, the existing assets, and build off of those so that when it's all done, it looks like it was all somehow an organic growth over time. And so we looked at the parcels along between the embankment of 91 and Market Street. We have no ideas yet for that, I'd have to be honest with you, but we can brainstorm if you'd like. We looked very carefully at the intersection of Main and Trumbull, which is kind of the 100% corner just north of 84. It's where, from an image standpoint, we think there's a lot of opportunity. We looked at ways to capitalize on what's a very successful emerging block and series of structures, to capitalize on that scale and make it work better around Anuccello, which recently was dead-ended up where it meets the intersection of many streets, I call it. There are a couple of vacant lots right in the heart of downtown West that we think want to be redeveloped at the same scale as the existing buildings. That's not a place for high-rises. And then we looked at the parcels along Bushnell Park, which are the kind of higher value parcels for development that would capitalize on views of the Capitol and the park. And then the vacant lot right along at the end of Pratt Street on Main there, which we think, just in terms of city building, is a pretty awesome site for something, because it's a funny place for a big vacant lot. And we chose those sites to kind of zero in. And the logic of that is that a market analysis, and Kevin's going to talk about it in a minute, says things like there's a capacity probably of X amount of housing units over 10 years and Y amount of retail. There's two ways that a city can take that information. One is to just know it and let any developer come and build wherever they want to, which in a way, if it's as-of-right zoning, you kind of have to anyway. The other is to say, you want to come develop here? Let's try to focus that action in a couple of key places, because if we can seed those sites as priority sites, then it's better for all the properties in between. And what we like about the sites that we chose is they're only a 3 to 5 minute walk between each of them. They become islands of activity with a quick walk between to help encourage in an earlier phase a kind of walkable downtown. Because our goal is to get the walk from downtown south of 84 and the neighborhood to the north to seem like one thing as much as possible. So rather than thinking the answer is to bridge over the highway, we think the answer actually is to make that walk from one to the other both desirable but also pleasant through the way that buildings with active street edges actually contribute to a kind of walkable vision of what a city should be. And so these are the sites that we looked at. And so here they are. We looked at a set of parcels. This is Anicello here that are primarily city-owned. The new life safety building is there, the cordon things, that existing retail. Those are nice buildings along that edge. We have the Main and Trumbull intersection, which is a kind of no man's land now in terms of vacant lots. So it's where we were able to concentrate the most new development energy, perhaps. This is the Main and Asylum Pratt Street parking lot that seems like a pretty sweet site, maybe for downtown residential. The Bushnell Park sites, the downtown west sites, you see there's a big vacant, there's a big parking lot, surface parking lot, hole in an otherwise very nice kind of urban fabric by the train station, and then just the context of the overall map again. So what we did is that we decided for a minute to think, what if we put ground level retail, not everywhere, but where it made the most sense in terms of corner sites, visibility, and this is not the stuff, this is not strip shopping center stuff, it's stuff where you park in the back or you walk to and it actually is along the street, and we put housing above. Because there was a parallel housing study going on, and because you've got a lot of office space in Hartford right now. So the market, at least in the next 5 years, is tipped much more to residential. And what if we could just imagine what the best scale of that development would be, feathered from the downtown towards the neighborhoods to the north, and also feathered to lower scale in downtown west. And what we did is we ran the scenarios to generate data to know how many units to compare that to the market study. Does that make sense? It looks a little essential, see. And so what you're seeing here on the map are actual little buildings that we tested, not in terms of architecture, but just in terms of the massing, setbacks, the actual footprints that these kinds of buildings want to have. And so what you're seeing literally are, in the yellow, little apartment units around a corridor on top of the pink, which is the retail, which is always deeper from the sidewalk. Okay, that was our methodology. It's like running the early stage of a science experiment. It's not a design, it's a scenario. And I'll start as an example, the Anicello site. Our first decision was that because the street has already been cut off and is more of a neighborhood street, it might work better to also stop the street in this direction and introduce a new street that actually runs east-west. Because one of the challenges with downtown north is all of the streets run this way and no streets run this way. And that would create more connections for people in a new district to be able, a neighborhood to be able to move back and forth. And so what we did is we lined the vacant lots with row houses, three stories, three and a half stories, with parking actually on the backside off of alleys. They have stoops on the front. That's what, these are all row houses. We put corner stores at the corner of Pleasant and Main and on High Street here. We put a little apartment building at this corner, and we put a parking garage for the larger district needs along Chapel Street where the highway goes down into 84 anyway. So we're in a way customizing an urban vision for those parcels that's not super specific, but it's specific enough if a developer comes in to see Tom and they are interested in one of the city parcels. Tom's got an expectation he can show them. We don't want a strip shopping center here with parking in front. We want something that mimics the kind of urban qualities that maybe were once there and are certainly there in terms of the fragment of the buildings that are still there. And also, we wanted to be very clear to the development community that we want a mix of heights. We don't want a big single building to land in the middle of these parcels surrounded by a kind of more suburban landscape. And so this is what it looks like in three dimensions. Again, it's more like Monopoly sugar cubes than architecture. The red color-ish color is where we're proposing the retail. There's retail there, a corner store there, a corner store there. The yellow represents how many floors are residential. So this is four floors of apartments above shops on the ground floor. And again, these are two and three story row houses with little commercial buildings that are kind of at the end of the block. And you can see that what we're doing by introducing a new street is that we're getting a new street that we can fully design to make a little neighborhood there. And otherwise, what's a little bit of a no man's land. So that's the Anu Cello study that we did. It yields a total of 129 units, which are a mix of row houses and apartments, 19,000 square feet of retail, and that, you know, is a kind of maximum. The market probably isn't going to want that much. And then a number of parking spaces. We try to, throughout the study, supply at least one parking space per residential unit as a kind of exercise. Because one of the challenges with designing a little urban neighborhood from scratch is that unlike neighborhoods that arose like this in the 1920s and 30s, where very few people had cars, we need to hide all the cars somewhere without having to detract from the quality of a residential walkable street. At the same time, we redesigned all of the streets. And so what we've done is we've taken the public right-of-way of all of the streets in downtown North, which have these enormously wide lanes. For example, federal recommendations now for urban streets are lanes of 10 and 11 feet. Most of the lanes in the district are 14 feet. What we do is called a lane diet, where you take the public right-of-way, you put all the lanes on a diet, and you give all that real estate back to the pedestrians to make the sidewalks wider and to be able to put street trees in. So we played the lane diet game for all the streets that we looked at. So here's a kind of before and after. And we also, in some cases, have recommended that when the developers come, because the sidewalks are still too small, you should set all of your buildings back and give it back to the public realm to get even a wider sidewalk. So we're designing the street at the same time that we're thinking about the basic mass and the basic setbacks of the buildings. This is the highway. This is a rethinking of North Chapel, which still is a highway edge, but we make it a much more walkable street than it is today. And this is a rethinking of what Walnut Street might be like with bike lanes, more sidewalk. We're also, not in this case, but big proponents generally of parallel parking. Parallel parking makes streets more walkable. It's a level of protection between moving traffic and the sidewalk. Those are also a good thing from an urban design standpoint. Main and Trumbull is where we propose slightly higher densities, because it's the thing closest to downtown. It's also true that real estate development either builds wood frame construction up to five stories, or it builds concrete and steel frame, in which case the costs require a building to be more like 10 and 11 stories. Developers don't like seven-story buildings because it requires steel frame, which is a higher construction cost, but you're not making up the extra cost of that. So we were very conscious of that because Tom's got to market this plan to developers so they come and actually build what we're showing. And so what we've proposed here, right at the intersection are taller buildings, 10, 11 stories, right at the corner only. So when you're at downtown looking that way, it looks like it's part of downtown. You look up, you don't even know you're crossing 84, you still think you're walking around. And then immediately behind, the buildings step down from 5 to 4 stories as they dovetail into Albany Street. That's the basic idea. And also because the hill drops down, as you know, from Main down to Market this way, we're able to play the hide the parking game, where as the parcels terrace down, we can use that to get relatively inexpensive parking, and then down the hill where you get those big buildings that aren't moving soon, you might build in some parking decks but not where we want the pedestrian activity. So we get the cars as much as we can out of the picture for that main, very important Main Street connection up to Main and up to Albany Street, which is vital from a kind of placemaking standpoint. And so this is the proposal for the massing. This is the office building that Tom was talking about. There isn't a market now. This might be a place where it might be a municipal office building, which would help it be financed short term. Here, blue is commercial, although we're also making the grocery store here blue too. That's an accident. That's a color accident. I just talked to Drew. This should not be blue. These are 10, 11 story apartment buildings just at the intersection. They step down to 5-story and 4-story buildings behind. And our row houses, which aren't turned on, are just behind here. So again, we're trying to get a radically different market mix of housing all in a very close proximity. We don't want to have all the same kinds of buildings. This is a proposed grocery store of 30,000 square feet. Again, the color's wrong. Our retail consultant wants the front door of that to face the other retail. So after you leave the grocery store, you see something across the street and say, you know, I need some new shoes, so I'm going to go there. And the parking for that is actually tucked under the grocery store the way a lot of urban grocery stores work. So there's lots of parking on a lower level. There's escalators up, and they bring the things down 11 to your car as a kind of model for what they, and there's an apartment building above. It says groceries there on the sign. It's hard to see. And so this is a rendering of that intersection. This is the sign of the grocery store facing this way, the plaza in front, other retail that all faces that. This is Main and Trumbull. And you'll see in a minute some ideas for improving the design of the open space that these buildings would all face. And you can see that there has been a lot of lane diet action here, where those very wide streets have been pulled in. We've kept the lane capacity, but just made them narrower to get bike lanes, curb extensions so the crosswalks are shorter. This would all be timed to a much smarter traffic signals, a timing sequence. So these would be very easy streets to cross. This is the office building. Housing, all retail, all facing that. We always call this the kind of 100% corner here. And then Main Street itself, you can see that it's all about managing the dimensions across the cross section. You take the exact same dimension and you redeploy it for a better balance of people, bicycles, and automobiles. And you can see that the character then is radically changed, especially when you get architecture on the sides of it. It's very different than this. And this is Trumbull Street. The next site, the next couple of sites are south of 84. One is, and this is, I think the highest density scheme we tried, is at the corner of Asylum and Main. The idea here is that there's one building on Pratt Street that isn't quite as nice as all the rest. I think it's a 1940s, and I don't know if the property owner's here, this might be a good deal for him. That becomes an arcade off of Pratt Street to get to the lobby of a new residential building. And the people that live in this building are gonna come down to their lobby, walk through the arcade, and pump into Pratt Street, bringing happiness and joy to all the business owners. This is the idea. And we had to get parking on the site because how the people who live in high-rise housing in Hartford want parking. And so the plan is, here it is, it's the tallest building we proposed. Here's that arcade running back, is that we get the parking above new retail on Main Street, and we get quite a few units there, 437. Again, the request from the city was, let's test the maximum from an urban design standpoint that we can actually get to work in terms of the numbers, the connectivity. This is, again, I'm not up here to say that there's a market for this building right now, but we wanted to test it. We wanted to push it. So we're going from townhouses on Anicello to one of the higher high-rises that we tested, because the question might be, what are the two best high-rise sites for residential in Hartford? They shouldn't go everywhere. And then the Bushnell Park properties, our plan here was to do mid-rise in the front row that mimic the scale of the existing buildings there, and then do a slightly higher building in the second row behind. That's up near the Goodwin Building too, so the scale of that seemed to work well in terms of the relationship of the skyline. And so again, what we're doing is that we're providing for Tom and his staff an aggregate vision that's not only an urban design vision about where high rise should go and not go and where low rise should go, but even a sense of what's the maximum physical number of residential units that we can do north of the park, because I need to know that number against other city policy issues, and we can talk about that too. So, and then downtown west, we proposed more 4 or 5 story stuff because the street grid is very dense. The existing buildings are of that scale, and we think that as those surface parking lots get filled in, it's going to enhance the place of that distinct from the high-rise part of downtown. We want to make sure that each part of downtown has its own kind of character. And so in this case, you can see that they kind of knit in like they were always there in terms of their performance. We were able to sneak the parking in very clever ways to get the parking to one space per unit on site, just to be conservative again about how we handle that. And this is the kind of scale and character that we're talking about there. So you can see we really took downtown north of Bushnell Park out for kind of a test drive, just to see what the capacity was and to understand it. And this is the downtown west idea, that you can kind of hide the parking kind of behind the buildings in the middle of the blocks. And again, we did a kind of lane diet test. There's less real estate to play with there than north of 84, because it's pre-urban renewal streets. Urban renewal gives you all kinds of streetscape real estate. These are historic streets, so we can do a little monkeying around, but we can't go for it, which is fine. And so this is a kind of aggregate vision. And so when we were doing these, we were always testing them against the entire skyline to figure out where heights even want to go from a design standpoint. This is not an arbitrary thing. In a way, we think it's very important that you craft density and think about the city as a whole as a design problem, so that you're putting higher buildings where they make sense relative to other higher buildings as a kind of, it's almost like common law, where you kind of follow the organic logics moving ahead. Since it's generated plenty of units anyway, for example, the Discovery here, it's not a good idea to promote a high rise in downtown West, because there's other sites that are actually better for it. So that's the kind of urban design parcel testing piece. Kevin Hively is now going to talk a little bit about what the market, Kevin's still here, what the market says about some of the things that we tested. I think you use this one.
Can you all hear me? Thanks. I've never seen, I don't even think at my wedding I saw so many skeptical people. And some of you in this room knows how that ended, so. So there you go. Hey, good, levity. So what I want to do is, I'm going to do something that no consultant should ever do, which is I'm going to talk about somebody else's study first. Bob Gibbs, who's a nationally known retail consultant, did our housing study and what did the retail study. And what I want to say from the outset is what Bob did was, again, in a very similar way to what Tim said, which is like, what is, when you're doing planning, it's like, what is kind of the maximum? What is that kind of outer envelope? Which is a very different thing than saying what could actually happen or how long it may take for it to happen. So one thing I want to just clarify is one of the things that you do when you do retail studies is you create a trade area, and that trade area is usually defined by drive times. And so it's some people do 5 minutes, some people do 10, 15, 20. It very much depends on what kind of store you want to have. And so the blue area, so you have the three areas, the green, which is kind of the primary trade area, the outside trade area, and then the very outside edge, and that's the total trade area that you have. And I'm not going to read the statistics, but you can see what that income looks like. Here's what the primary trade area looks like, and you can see that it basically goes up into the Clay Arsenal area, etc. And what this would suggest is that there's about $163,000 square feet of retail, broadly defined, that can be supported. What I want to do is explain this for a second. One of the issues with doing this is a very gross number, but you all have been shopping, and what I want you to do is, for those of you who've been to a Target, is I want you to put a Target in your head for a second and think about how big a Target is, okay? A regular Target that doesn't have a grocery store is on average 135,000 square feet. If it has a grocery store, it's 175,000 square feet. The Targets that Target is opening up in five downtowns across the country, which are called City Target, are around 80,000 square feet. So let's kind of put that in context. So when you look at this, what you actually have to do is think about these things in terms of what their categories are. So the biggest category is restaurants. And how is that calculated? Well, how it's basically calculated is they look at the income of the people in the area, including the people who work downtown, and then they look at what the sales estimates are. They look at things like meals, they look at things like taxes that are generated, they look at credit card receipts, and they come up with a calculation. And based upon how many people are there and what their typical spending budgets are, versus how much sales are generated, that difference suggests that there's an opportunity here. Grocery, all of you recognize that there is a food desert in kind of the North Hartford area, if you will. And then this is an area called GAFO. And what GAFO basically is, it's general merchandise, it's athletic equipment, it's furniture, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And this is roughly what those looks like. Now here's the problem. It's very hard to think about what these things are in terms of a tenant mix, because let's just think about an apparel store for a second. There is a wide, wide range of apparel sold at very, very different price points. Some of it is extraordinarily expensive, like in Hermes, and some of it is, you know, stuff like I give to my kids because they grow so fast. And when you look at this stuff, you sit back and say, 10,000 square feet. What kind of store is that? Well, the problem is this 10,000 square feet is really divided by all those different categories. But what it's suggestive of is that there's retail demand in the area that's not being met. Can it translate into a lease? It's a good question. But what it does suggest is that there's a retail demand that could be met. And why I wanted you to think about the Target for a second is, so the Target that doesn't have a grocery store, this is smaller than the Targets that are being opened up inside urban centers across the United States. So it seems like it's a lot. It's smaller. It's less than half the size of an average Target, and it's smaller than the Targets that they're opening. So it feels like a lot. It's not a huge amount. The question here is about really what happens with the restaurants. So this is basically what the rationale is. The Excel Center, there's a lot of daytime employment. There's $46 million for the spending power, which is almost as much as what there is in the neighborhood, et cetera, all of the surrounding neighborhoods, et cetera. And so this is what that would translate to. The downtown west area is a little bit different. And this is something that I want to point out. And again, these are based upon what maximums are. So basically how these types of things are calculated, which is, what are the sales? There are typical ratios of sales per square foot that are needed to basically support the operations of a store. And then those are just translated into square feet. So one of the things that you look at here is, so this is 151 square feet of a furniture store that doesn't exist. I mean, the IKEA catalog is almost 151 square feet if you actually laid it out, right? So the point about this is that when you start thinking about it, it's really important to understand what's kind of in and underneath the number. So this is not saying that there should be a furniture store. As a matter of fact, what it says is there's probably not going to be a furniture store. But what it does say is, again, because there's so much demand from, in this case, not from residents, but from people who are working in and around the area, that maybe there's more restaurant activity than is possible. So now we're going to talk about the downtown housing study that we did. The downtown housing study was part of a much bigger study about housing across the city that we were also responsible for. And Laura's in the back. Can you just hold up? Just so you guys know, the problem with doing these things is that you don't get to see everything. We did a lot of work. A lot of work on this. And basically we're trying to take several hundred pages and turn it into 10 minutes. And so that's always the danger, so you kind of don't always get to see the complete story. So what we did is we did three things. And the reason why we did these three things is basically this. How do you define a market when no one can see one? And the example that I would ask you all to think about is the minivan, or a computer, or the smartphone. How do you do a market analysis for something that you can't see yet, or don't even know what you want? So what we did, our firm do this type of work, but we also do a lot of business strategy consulting. And our business strategy consulting work that we do a lot of work with marketing and product development. And in our marketing and product development work, you do things very differently than just kind of looking at history and trying to project it forward. You try to figure out who's the target customer, how many there might be, and what your capture rate is. So in order for us to figure that out in a market where the stuff kind of doesn't really exist, we did three things. We did a resident market research. So we did 368 surveys of people who both lived downtown and who did not live downtown. And I think we tried to get over 1,100, something like that, and that's about what we got in terms of responses. And we went out to events and solicited stuff. I mean, it wasn't just like in the email or in a box. We did a lot of work. We did four formal focus groups, of which I think some of the people in this room participated in, and then we also did three kind of informal ones, where we just got involved in discussions with people who were at different events across the city. We did some baseline demographic statistics, including something called psychographic segmentation, which I'm going to explain. It's going to make you giggle, but you're going to understand what it is when I put it to you in kind of a real-world reference. And then we looked at precedents. We looked at places that already had a lot of downtown housing. We had a list of, I believe we started with a list of 18 cities that we thought might be good places to look at. How we created that list was a couple of things. One was, were they ranked on like a Forbes or a Fortune or a Business Week or an Urban Living top 10 downtowns to live in? Did they make that list? What was their employment mix like? Did they have snow? Which we thought was kind of a big deal. And the other issue was, were they not near a big city where they kind of get the second city phenomenon? So example, one of the things that were on here was Westchester in New York, that had been suggested to us. We took Westchester off the list because Westchester has a 30-minute express train to Manhattan.
White Plains, you mean?
White Plains, I'm sorry. And it's just a completely different dynamic from what you would have in Hartford. So we said, they've done a lot of great stuff. They're 30 minutes from Manhattan, which is one of the most expensive residential markets in the world. We're not quite sure that's comparable. And then when you think about it, you don't really think Cleveland, Milwaukee, Kansas City, and Des Moines are hotbeds of urban living. But we can tell you that Cleveland has almost 10,000 people, has more than 10,000 people now living downtown. Milwaukee has about 20,000. Milwaukee has about 13,000. Kansas City has about 20,000-ish. And Des Moines has about 7,000. For purposes of comparison, as you think about it. The other thing is that Milwaukee and Des Moines are the next two ranked cities in terms of insurance employment in the United States. So in the focus groups, we heard a bunch of different things, and I'm not going to read all these, but you can see what they mean. And just so you know, it was an ethnically diverse group of people that we talked to. We talked to everybody. So a couple of these comments in here, like there aren't enough people like me living downtown, that also included minority professionals, who are like, where are they? And it also included a bunch of like 26-year-olds of like, where are they? They're hard to find, et cetera. And then we heard a bunch of stuff about the grocery store issues and things like that. The one thing that we heard about is the placemaking issues, which is, and for those of you who know, Hartford is a city with vast parking lots. And you kind of can walk to a building, then it's parking lot, parking lot, parking lot, and then you get to another building. And we heard over and over again, and in the much more in detailed study, you can go through all of the comments that everybody basically gave to us. From the survey, one of the things that we found out is that people want a mix of housing products. They don't want all high rises. And they don't want necessarily all want four-story apartment buildings. They want to have their own door on a street, et cetera, and you can see what it looks like here. One of the issues that we have is there's this thing in real estate when you're looking at housing known as absorption, which is basically if I build 1,000 units, how fast will they get occupied? When you have such a mix like this, it becomes really, really hard because what tends to happen in a marketplace is you use the general number. So right now in Hartford, depending upon who you believe, it's somewhere between 8 per month and 13 per month downtown. It's not a huge difference, but it makes a big difference when you're thinking about like 1,000 units and how long that would take to absorb them. So when you have such a mix like that, it makes it even harder because it actually makes it meaningless because that average is taken across all of the products that are offered, not for a specific product. What we found out is that there are aspirational reasons why people want to live in the city. They want to be close to the culture, it's closer to work and school, etc. They like the city life idea, whatever that means. And that's one of those kind of very personalized ideas. Very practical reasons are why they don't. There's not enough choice in housing. Stuff isn't open on the weekends. You can see what they are. It's very expensive to live downtown in some cases. Parking, simple things. So what we learned from our site is we actually went to all four of those cities and we spent several days in each one and we took a bunch of pictures and we talked to real estate agents and we did little mini discussions at Starbucks and different places like that just to get a feel for what was going on. The people were young. They were average between 29 and 32 on average. Most of the downtown housing was not right in the central business district. And what I mean by central business district, for those of you who don't know, is like where the big office towers are. It's actually on the fringes of downtown Hartford, on the fringes of which in most of Hartford is now parking lots, frankly. There are lots of different housing options available, everything from adaptive reuse of warehouses for lofts to micro units. For those of you who don't know what a micro unit is, it's about 400 square feet. It's got a bed and it's got a little kitchen and it looks like a little mini studio apartment to big, gigantic, beautiful high rises that cost $3 million. You have the whole range of options. There's not a lot of retail shopping. We have some pictures that will show that basically these really pretty facade improved places are essentially empty. But the nightlife stuff, restaurants, clubs, things to do, are very active. But the retail, going and buy goods and buy a good, is tough. And the other thing is that the groceries and fresh food are basically addressed by a public market model, which I don't know if we have pictures of in here, but I don't remember them making it in there. But basically, the easiest way to think about it is think about a farmer's market in a permanent structure with a lot of different vendors coming in and selling everything from food, from fresh vegetables to meats to prepared foods. And three out of the four cities had really nice, very elaborate ones right in the heart of their downtowns. So this is what the kind of housing looks like that people are building. So this is in Milwaukee, and you can see these are also apartments. These are old warehouses that were done, and then somebody built a tower behind. This is in Kansas City. You've got kind of a contemporary townhouse type model and standard apartments. This is in Des Moines, Iowa. You can see that these are basically townhouse, row house type styles. This is in Des Moines, and this is in Des Moines. This is a really active restaurant down. You can see, but it's basically what Tim was saying. It's in that four-story range. The one thing that's different about what you saw presented is that it kind of sits there by itself. It's not block after block after block of them. And then this is in Milwaukee, which is built along the edge of the river. The other thing that took place in every one of these cities that we went to, and it was happening in parallel, and think about what we talked about when we described what people were looking for and the issues that they had about living downtown, was they were doing placemaking at the same time. But it wasn't placemaking in the grand scheme of it. Some of it was very grand, which I'll show you in a minute, but some of it was also very small. So in a number of communities, this is in Des Moines, Iowa, they're hiding the parking garages behind trees and just kind of simple artwork. This is in Cleveland, Ohio. Same thing, it's behind glass panels, so you can't really see that it's a parking garage. This is a sculpture park that the public sector paid for. The sculpture is actually provided by a family, but it's a very large sculpture park, which, just for frame of reference, on the other side of this is Nationwide's agribusiness headquarters is on the other side of this. But there's a bunch of different, there's probably 13 pieces of very, very famous public art like this that was donated by the family, or gifted by the family to this park. Then there was little things, again, another example. So this is an office building, this is a new parking garage that was built, this is a liner building. That liner building is actually completely lit, so you can actually walk to that sculpture park at night and feel like it's daylight. It's a health club, and it's lit, so there's actually people looking out on the street, so you can actually feel safe. This is a pedestrian bridge crossing the river in Des Moines. This is a parking garage in Milwaukee. This is Northwestern Mutual's headquarters. This is a parking garage in Milwaukee right here. That's a park on top of it. This is in Milwaukee. This is a river walk that was bolted on to an existing, basically, pier. So that you can actually walk along the river, and you can walk along, and some of you I know have been to the Third Ward, which is what this area is known. It's an old warehouse district. And it was, because it was old warehouses, the warehouses were built right up to the river. So how do you create a walkable riverfront? Well, you just bolt it on. And I've been to Portland, Oregon, and they did the same thing too. As a matter of fact, in Portland, Oregon, they actually bolted on one of these onto a train trestle. So you can go across the train trestle to ride your bike and walk. And this is another example in Des Moines, Iowa, which is basically one of the things that they did is to line the streets, kind of what Tim was talking about, the streetscaping, which is, and this is the case to make it pedestrian. This is just downtown in the middle of the, at probably 8 o'clock at night, and you can see that they're along this street, they just basically line flower pots, just to kind of take the edge off of sidewalk to park. They were doing this in parallel. These weren't, let's go build housing, and then let's go do it. They were doing it in parallel, and what it does is it creates the effect of, I get a little bit of starter frontier type people in the housing, it's usually the really expensive stuff, then I can get some cheap stuff built, and then I got to get it moving because I got to be able to sustain it as a livable area, and that's part of behind what they're there. For those of you who don't know, this is a pump station for their sewer pump, for their water pump, for the downtown. And it's hidden, it's basically hidden behind this facade that they made as a piece of public art. So here's something that's really interesting, and this is one of the problems with, want to say that the piece that's in the big thing that Laura said is actually worded differently than what's here. So this is where you started in 2000 based upon census data and other things. This is what the 2013, where the census and other things say you are, roughly. And this is what the projection is based upon your history. So here's the problem. You can't base off history. So why do we know this is wrong? Because you already have planned more units than this, right? So if you just use history, what you'd basically say is you got 100 units, you're done for the next 5 years. Thanks, we're over. See ya. But the whole point about this is trying to plan for things that you can't see, because I guarantee you that in 1998, nobody said 1,000. Nobody said that. Now, what's very interesting about understanding is what's happened. It is in the blue here is what happened in year 2000, and then the red is what happened in 2013. As you can see, in the year 2000, most of the people that were living downtown were 45 to 54 or 55 to 64. So they were just on the edge of being empty nesters, or they were probably maybe divorced single people, some model like that. By 2013, it changed dramatically. Most of the people were between the ages of 25 and 34. I mean, the vast majority of people were between the ages of 25 and 34. So, psychographics, what is it? These are not my names, these are Nielsen's names. So if you don't like these, call Nielsen and complain. What psychographics are is something that's kind of really spooky and scary when you think about it, but when they take your, they know that we can, they can figure out what you watch, they know what websites you go on to, they know what you buy through credit card data, they know what magazines you subscribe to, they know what car you buy, all through publicly available databases. And they put them together and they create profiles of people. So the easiest way to think about what these things are is, like, you heard them during elections, right? The suburban Philadelphia soccer mom voter. And how will they vote in a presidential election, because that could turn the Pennsylvania vote. That's essentially what this is. So what we did is, in order to figure out who might be interested in living in Hartford, one of the lessons that you learn when you work from a company is, well, who do I already have as customers, and how many more are there like them out there that I might be able to go get? So what we did is we used the Nielsen psychographic data, and we profiled the entire city by at the neighborhood level, and we pulled out, this is how many of these people who are basically in the area of affording market rate housing, and we'll explain what that means in a second. And this is how many live in the city right now by Nielsen's estimates. And this is what share of them live downtown, and this gives you an idea what their income levels are. The work in downtown, the other thing we wanted to find out is how many people of those type work downtown. And again, so this is the live down, this is live Hartford, live downtown, and the work downtown, and you can see that it's a little bit smaller than actually already live here. So we didn't count them. The other thing that we have to think about is, what's the price point? So who is it out there, and what might they be able to afford? So this is the median income of all the people that live in the downtown across by age groups. And this is how many people in those age groups can afford more than $100,000, have more than $100,000 in income. And it's about 28%. As you can see, the largest group right here has about 40% of the income of your wealthier group. Issue with 25 to 34-year-olds, which was much more prevalent today than it was, frankly, when I graduated from college, and certainly when most people graduated from college, is the level of college debt. It's a big issue. It drives everything that they can afford. So what we did is we took all of the median income numbers, and we calculated rent at 30% of income and rent at 25% of income and what they could afford, because that's kind of what the target ratios usually are. Then what we did is we took this translates to by month at those two categories, the $322 in college debt. The $322 in college debt was derived by, we took every college in the state of Connecticut. We got the data from a different source that we knew about that existed. We looked at what the average debt was for people graduating from that college. And it was about $26,000 or $28,000. I don't remember. That's kind of statewide. And we took that number, and by the way, it's about 70% of the kids are graduating with about that much debt, just so you know. And that's public and private institutions. And we took that debt and we calculated it, said, okay, well, you got to pay your student loan debt, because now they actually come after you for that stuff. So what we did is we took the difference between the 322 and what these were and said, this is what they can kind of afford. This is kind of the beginning starting point. And so as you can see, the bulk of the 25 to 34-year-olds were in basically this income category. And you're looking at around $750 to maybe $1,300, depending upon how you want to calculate it. You know, I would say probably $1,000 to $1,400, somewhere in that range on average. But you can't ignore this reality. And a lot of housing studies don't think about this. They just say, here's what they can afford. They give you a number of $2,600. And they completely forget that there's this whole other piece that is now a part of that equation. So then the question is, thinking about the pool of people that are out there, going back, so this is what they can afford, and this is what their incomes are, and how many are there? Then we looked at the entire metro area doing that same kind of psychographic analysis, and this is how many people there are. There's about, you have about nine, I can't remember exactly off the top of my head, but you have, you can see what there is here. There's 10,000. So Hartford represents 10,000 of this category of people, which means there's an addressable market of...
Keep on talking.
There's an addressable market of 9,200 people. What does an addressable market mean? It means the people that you already don't have. It's like what's kind of left over, right? So Hartford represents about 9% of that. Then what we did is we went back and we looked at the cities that we used as benchmarks, because they're much, much further along in terms of actually developing downtown housing. And we figured out what their ratios were relative to their total number of households, what downtown residents and their pools look like. And we basically came out that in one case, depending on this number, you could support 4,400 housing units pretty comfortably. Another perspective was this one, which was the downtown residents as part of the metro area, and what the benchmarks were. They were 0.5% to 1.1. You're only at 0.2 now. So looking at that number, that would take to about 13,000 people, which is about 7,400 units if you make this assumption about that is. At 0.5, you'd get to that. So that would suggest about another 3,000 to 5,000 housing units in total you could support. And whether that's plausible, well, there's 46,000 people who are in this demographic that in this market area already. Our survey suggested that 30 to 40% of these people would be interested in thinking about downtown. So the numbers are plausible. IRS data that we looked at shows that about 12 to 15,000 people move into Hartford County every year, and 7 to 9,000 on top of that move within Hartford County. So based upon those income distributions in a given year, that means there's about 1,400 to 2,000 people moving around that can afford the kind of market rate housing that we were talking about from a price point perspective. So what does that mean? So if you take the 4,400 to 7,400 units, you take the 1,600 roughly that you have now and the 1,100 that's basically planned, it suggests that between 1,700 and 4,700 units are plausible. But it's all about absorption. And absorption is going to be about a couple things. It's going to be about what the housing types are and what the price point is and how those two things combine. So we believe, based upon our work, that high-rise housing has a limited cap in how much you can actually probably move. Or even, frankly, housing that's at $2,000 a month, which I know for a lot of people sounds like a lot of money. For downtown housing, it's actually really cheap, in a relative speaking. But there's a limited market that could support levels of that high. Just so you know, the number of units that we're talking about, which is why this capture success issue becomes so important, at 4,700 units at your present average absorption rate, it's like 30 years. But you've already gone from 1,600 units to maybe adding another 1,000. So it is plausible that you could accelerate it. I believe, based upon looking at the history of other places that and how they've actually transpired, that if you don't do both together, placemaking and supporting a mix of housing types, it'll be very, very hard to get to the 4,700 number. I think 1,700 would be pretty easy. I think 4,700, 4,400 will be pretty hard over time. So our point is that, again, it's about the housing mix and type, and it's about that price point that you can bring it in at. And you gotta do some stuff to make sure that the downtown residential living experience is something that people actually want. Because now you're beyond what's known as kind of the explorer pioneer stage. Now you're starting to think about settlers. And the question is, those settlers want things that the pioneers didn't.
So just to put this in perspective, the development scenarios that we showed in total showed 2,100 units. To show the picture against what Kevin talked about. So if the range is 1,700 to 4,700, we were somewhere in the middle with the amount of yellow we had in our three-dimensional diagram. Does that make sense?
A lot of the specific details of what the downtown streets might look like, because Tim already talked about that earlier. But what's fundamental is just what Kevin said, is placemaking, is creating walkable communities. And I think a lot of you already can get the impression that once you go north of the highway, that isn't so walkable. This is what sells in markets all around the U.S. This is why people are living in the downtowns of Milwaukee and Des Moines more and more, and many other cities around the United States. It's got a lot to do with the younger generations that are buying these products. And one of the things that might be able to make Hartford more appealing and accelerate absorption would certainly be making it a more walkable, integrated downtown, in particular that connects with your successful parts of the downtown, as well as surrounding residential neighborhoods. And right now, there's a few big obstacles. We already know there's a lot of traffic on these streets. We already know that they're awfully wide. And Tim showed you how we're already talking about trying to narrow up those streets. And by the way, every single one of those streets, even narrowed up, still has plenty of roadway capacity for all of the volumes. We've done the transportation analysis in the background. These streets are overbuilt by at least 100%. But part of the urban design framework that Tim laid out also says that new connections are necessary. And the reason for adding new connections and new streets has everything to do with continuing to make that place more walkable. Some of these block dimensions are just simply too long. And by adding new streets, not only do you get access to parking out back, you get access through blocks to places that folks want to be. You make it much easier to just go out of your building and turn the corner and go to something nice, as opposed to go out of your building and realize it's a 600-foot walk down the block, so you might as well just drive. And that's part of what a lot of the generation that's buying housing in downtowns is seeing, is an interest in not having to worry about the car. That we definitely don't need more than one car per household in an urban condition. And so new streets are going to be a big part of that. You might be able to activate any level of development on High Street and how you might get there. You'll see right away that it's very, if you're coming from the north from the south to try to get into this district, in particular from something like Union Station, if you're riding the train, or even if you're just in the entertainment districts, to get up here, you can't. So we're suggesting that High Street becomes a two-way street all the way through, even in the west part of downtown and across the highway, because today you've got to literally loop all the way around through other neighborhoods. This isn't a good thing for marketing those properties, isn't a good thing for vehicular access, but it also has a negative impact on the pedestrian environment, because there's a lot of extra driving around that has to happen in order to get to a destination, or on this map, in order to get out of that destination. Let's say we're trying to go to the north. If you're on High Street and you turn out, you literally got to go through tons of signals and cross over the highway and do all sorts of stuff just to get out to the north. So by a simple change in two-way streets, you make it easier from the vehicular perspective, but you're also making this street a slower street. With two-way traffic, oncoming vehicles, it's much more pedestrianized because there isn't the ability to just shoot down on a lot of these one-way streets that exist. And it has a big change. And one of the biggest things that you can do as a result of making a two-way High Street is changing how Walnut and High works. Walnut and High is an interesting sort of forgotten intersection because it's the on-ramp to get onto 84 West. But it's actually the closest intersection in this entire neighborhood to the existing residential community to the northwest. And when you think about what High Street can be, the walking distance from Union Station, from the train station into this neighborhood, is actually shorter than walking from the Excel Center down to Commonwealth Plaza. It's right there. You can get there really quickly, except walking up that street today, this is a scary, big on-ramp condition. Well, here's the aerial of it. I mean, there's nothing appealing about walking through this environment, and frankly, the one crosswalk is generally not really well noticed and hard to maintain because there's so many cars turning across it. And so the suggestion is that this intersection could actually be a lot more walkable, but handle just as many cars and allow for the two-way movement to make High Street an actual urban street integrated directly into the downtown fabric to the south. And as Tim said earlier, make the bridging of the highway, even with the placement of street trees on the bridge, make it feel like a transparent movement as a pedestrian getting into this neighborhood. Now, another key intersection that needs a little bit of thinking is this lovely crash site at Albany and Main, which is really what it should be, is a gateway not only to this district but to all of downtown. And what happens is it's actually more or less a conflict point. And if you've ever been through it, where you know you may know if you're a regular how to shoot through this thing and make it work really well. This is, you know, the lovely Google Street View camera caught exactly what really is one of the biggest problems here, is when folks are coming down Albany and they actually want to take a left, and there's that car that just nose through, and sometimes you don't know what they're doing because the intersection is so big. When that person's trying to take that left and they're waiting out in the middle of space. Who knows what's going to happen next? And this is actually a collision point as cars are trying to get to Albany. You know, maybe they don't happen to have their left turn signal on because it doesn't look like a left turn. And you think they're going straight up high, I'm sorry, up Main, and in fact they're turning left. So rationalizing this can have two benefits. One, making it a lot safer. But two, making this a significantly better walking environment and a better public realm. Again, an environment where significantly shorter crossings, we can even tighten this up maybe a little bit more, but the change in all of this lane capacity to what is an environment that's actually walkable, a nice raised slip lane as opposed to the kind of off-ramp that's there today, this becomes a standard four-way intersection. We reduce the angles, the way the cars are coming in, make it much closer to 90-degree angles, and as a result, make it much more like a typical urban intersection that you might find anywhere else in the city. And while we're not really changing the geometry of Main and Trumbull, we're certainly changing the character of this as sort of this knuckle, this key drawing point across the highway. And I'd like to point out some really important features that you also saw in Main and Albany. Has everything to do with connectivity. I mean, this is going, Trumbull already is developing as an important spine in the downtown, and we see that eventually continuing. But here's Main Street, and the two of them come together at this point, whether it's a grocery store or other retail, whatever it may be. This is today just a traffic conflict point. We actually want it to be a community intersection by all modes of movement. So the idea is that there's so much extra lane capacity on Main Street, far more than any projections thinking you'd ever need to put on there. You can actually get rid of extra lanes, putting in raised cycling tracks the length of Main Street from Albany all the way into downtown. It'd be wonderful if someday that kind of environment continued. So it's actually a safe environment. But what cycle tracks do is not only just make it easier for bicyclists, they are part of creating a wider, safer space and protection for the pedestrians in the sidewalks away from the traffic. We're able to add on-street parking the entire length of Main Street and still keep a median with nice turn pockets to keep the capacity moving. Hopefully, Trumbull Street would also have bike lanes. There's bike boxes to encourage left-hand turns. This kind of an environment is part of the complete streets sort of a toolbox that's going across the nation in many cities, and it can easily be retrofit into these existing streets.
Last chapter, we promise. Hang in there.
All right, thank you. My name is Scott Bishop, principal at STAS. I'm actually going to talk a little bit about why the open space network is important and how we actually build that. Just to touch on what the open space does, the open space actually gives dimension to what Tim had talked about in terms of that development, how the city form works. It's also that amenity that Kevin had talked about, which is what people need when they live in cities, and it also supplies that connectivity that Jason had talked about. It also includes things like skate parks, just in case you were wondering. So, in fact, Hartford has some great open spaces already. This is Riverside Park. It's a very nice park that's been part of the city for a long time. Part of what's happened, though, is that it's been divided by all of the highways that have come in over time. And you can see the character of this allows you to experience really the river, which is an awesome amenity for people in downtown. Part of the issue, though, is like how do you get to that park? And this is what we call Thunderdome sometimes. I know that's not its official name, but it's very difficult to get over those large highways that are in that now kind of dividing that space. So one of the things that we do is we try to think about these things as even larger networks from what's in the district. And there's some very nice large open spaces that could create even a larger kind of circuit for people to recreate and also to connect them to the city as a way to get to their jobs. And so you can see here Riverside Park connecting up to the north, up to the State Park, back down to Kenny Park, and then even the cemeteries are part of this open space network. So how can we utilize that to actually draw people into North Park District? And there's a few simple moves that we can start to make in terms of open space within the district and how we can start to stitch together that larger framework. And some of these are really about how you create these gateways. So really kind of decisive moves about how you get over, and some of them are about improving what's there already. So again, if you think about those larger open spaces, these are really these connections that kind of stitch everything together. So how we get from North Branch, how do we utilize a large landform to create a connection to the park that starts to deal with the what we know as Thunderdome? How do we make some other connections further on down so you can start to utilize this all as a network for transportation, for recreation? And then how do we think about a space that's basically the signature open space for the district, and that kind of ties everything together? So one of the first concepts that we looked at is how you kind of make some of these difficult connections. These are not easy to weave, But some of them are more suited towards pedestrian connections, while others might be more suitable for bikeway connections. This connection is really trying to weave through a lot of on-ramps and off-ramps, but it's really to create a series of connections to the open space, which we feel is really the primary kind of recreational space. So can we create a new pedestrian connection over the existing rail cap, for example? How do we get to this space? And so the first way that we looked at it is really utilizing portions of the on-ramp to 84, because that's actually a little bit wider than what is necessary. So if we take some of that and utilize that, we can move people up and over and actually create an interesting space up on the rail cap that people can look out and view the river from up high. They can then make their way back down into the open space itself. There's examples of how this happens in many urban places, so it's not going to just be your kind of normal and typical way to access the space. In fact, there's ways to really make it a gateway. The next is really more apt to making this bicycle connection. Again, we're looking at that rail cap infrastructure and quite a tangle of road and highway infrastructures. But there are ways that we can weave there. In fact, you can see, and I don't know how many of you have actually been up here, but there is an existing connection that gets you onto the Founders Bridge there. So that's really critical. In fact, we know we can get there, so that's not something that we're making up here. And that's what makes this one feasible in a way, is that there's already some of these connections occurring. So how can we utilize and expand on that existing pedestrian connection to the bridge and create this new kind of bike connection and pedestrian way? You can see that there's what we have is the flood wall infrastructure here. But off in the distance, you can see where the sidewalk was up on the bridge here. And this is kind of that view looking down. So there is actually a way that we can accomplish this. And the idea is to, again, try to expand some of the areas where to get it, basically getting from solid ground and then up and over and onto the rail cap. So expanding that a little bit on the exit ramp, but also then utilizing potentially the existing connection, or there's actually an alternate route to this. It's not there, but potentially there's also an opportunity to go this way down. But the real point is that there's a way that we can utilize infrastructure to make this all happen. This is happening in Boston, of course, and other places where it becomes a critical connection, and it's really allowing for that to be an amenity for the district. And so this is how we kind of conceptualize this, that we can actually make that connection. And this is something it's almost a prefabricated bridge structure. It's not something that's going to take huge dollars, but it's something that can make some of these important opportunities happen. The next kind of gateway connection is utilizing, again, this existing not so fantastic bridge structure. So how do we amenitize that? How do we make this something that's approachable? Right now, one of the issues that you see is that it's really in the middle of nowhere on this side. So to get there, you see it off in the distance, like this, for example, not very approachable as a structure. So how do we then make a new connection? And we really are thinking about making a land bridge, and that bridge not only helps with issues in terms of stormwater management on the highway, but potentially can help out with how you might see and vision this place from the highway. So really we're making that connection instead of across a series of parking lots and no man's land. How do we make a connection from Market Street and then up and over? As this landform rises up, we can actually make a connection to the top of the structure instead of having to go up the kind of maze of Thunderdome here, and then make your way across the bridge and then back down. And then again, talking about how we actually build a forest buffer along that edge that will help in terms of the future development, but also dealing with stormwater management as an ecological practice. in dealing with some of the runoff from I-91. And there's ways that we can think about, of course, changing that bridging structure. It may just kind of be a reskinning, right? It's not necessarily that we have to tear down that whole thing. It's really how you repurpose what's already there and making it interesting. And then again, that actually serves as a visual gateway for the district from the highway. So people will identify that as a landmark. And these are just examples of how you can utilize landform in getting from one place to another and the fact that it can actually be an interesting design element. All right, finally, the moment you've all been waiting for. You can utilize a larger open space within this for larger events, so creating a flexible space. So it really becomes a space for everybody. It's not just a space for one type of use or another. So it's a flexible, open, central space. And I just wanted to point out, I know it's a little bit difficult to see, and I'm going to zoom in on it, but we're not necessarily saying we're going to take away a skate park. What we're thinking about is how we actually create a better skate park within the context of a really expanded central open space.
Point out
space.
The climbing wall, too. Yeah.
Say that again?
Point out the climbing wall, too.
So we talked a little bit about the climbing wall, right? So it's this combination of active space and passive space, and that's really where you kind of, you know, some people just want to sit and watch skateboarders do cool things, because we can't do them anymore, we're too old. But what I wanted to show is what we're showing, even in the rendering, is that this space here is what is going in right now. This space is really actually an expanded footprint of that, and a little more interesting, potentially. A lot of what they're constructing there can be reutilized as well and expanded on to be integrated into a larger park. So I hope that is what you guys were hoping for. I hope you weren't saying, get rid of the skate park, right? All right, anyway, I'll give it back to Tim.
Yeah, I think that's, thanks for being patient. We went through a lot of material. I think Tom was gonna field questions and then Scott, Jason, and Kevin and I can help Tom, depending on what kind of question you've got for us.
So thank you for, as Tim said, thank you for being patient. That was a lot of information. We've been working a lot to try to understand the market and what's out there. And I was reminded that one of the problems with using this space is that we do have a closing time. We have to be out of here by 8. So. This went a lot longer than I thought it was going to go, so we're going to try to keep the quick questions short and the answers short. Yes. Yep.
So one of the biggest complaints of people that I know coming to Hartford is always finding parking. And I noticed that you guys did a great job repurposing the vacant slots, so that looked awesome. But one thing I noticed is that you were trying to target one residential unit for one parking spot. So the question I have is, what about all the parking for the people that come into Hartford and don't live here?
There is a lot of parking in the city. Unfortunately, it might not be located at the spots that are convenient, or the pricing may be wrong. And we have been discussing with the parking authority the whole concept of pricing and how we shift the pricing around and how we try to attract and make other parking more affordable. One of the other things that we've been discussing and we're going to start looking at is the fact that we believe that we have to think of parking almost as an infrastructure the same way we think of sewer and water. You don't pay the full cost of the sewer and water. It is subsidized in some way, but it's done in a way to allow development to happen and other things to happen. We need to think differently about parking, and so we're in the process right now of finalizing a contract with a parking consultant to help us reshape that. We're getting ready to establish a very broad parking committee with all the parking owners to try to help us work through that, and we're going to create a citizens committee and a business committee to also advise us on that. So it is a big issue. We have to think it through. Right here. Yeah. I'll get it.
There's a youth center on Pleasant Street. Mm-hmm. Have you spoken to the director there? Because I see one of the plans. You might be placing living apartments that will surround it?
We have talked to the youth center, and we will continue discussions with them as we move forward. Those buildings on that section of Main Street are very historic. We believe they have a lot of character and have a lot of vibrancy that can be used for the neighborhood. There's some good businesses there, so we need to figure out how we work with them to grow and expand.
I'm referring to the youth center and boxing gym behind it.
I know what you're referring to.
Okay, thank you.
There's three in a row over here. We'll get to you first. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, starting in the front, or and keep going back. Keep going.
Here?
Oh, all right, we'll go there.
She's gonna read something.
Good. Go ahead.
You can say that. That's fine.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Riva Dionarine. I'm 17 years old. I am a high school student at the Greater Hartford Academy of Math and Science and Aerospace and Engineering. I live in Hartford, Connecticut, and I'm also a Hartford resident. What I want to know is, have you heard any of the stereotypes about skating? Anyone? Raise your hands.
Have you heard what, please?
Stereotypes. 1, 2, 3. Okay. All right, so some of the stereotypes are...
Oh.
Girls just aren't that good at skating, and therefore don't belong at skate sports. Or simply, it's a bad scene. Those are just two of the stereotypes of many. I'm here to debunk both. Girls do skate, and it's not a bad scene. Otherwise, my mom wouldn't be here to support me. I'm here to tell you all that this sport does help young girls with a passion for skating. The reason why I began skating was because I've always been a little shy meeting new people. While I'm outgoing, I'm still a bit shy. I decided skating might be something that I would enjoy, but I would also fit in. I've met many friends since. While I love school and I hope to go to medical school in the near future, skating is my passion. Passion is a powerful force. Convincing my parents, on the other hand, proved challenging. I already mentioned the stereotypes, but they were very apprehensive. I was convincing enough, though, when they saw how very serious I was about it. They bought me a deck and everything I needed.
Wow.
This wasn't a phase. I begged my mom to drive me around to different parks outside of Hartford on weekends and other skate-related activities, since there weren't any nearby. Many of my friends skated at Heaven, and since I was closer, it was a better place to be, and I could be closer to my friends. Last year, the city's Charter Oak Temple Restoration Association was rewarded not one, not two, but a $10,000 grant from the Tony Hawk Foundation. This grant is probably one of the most significant to us in the city of Hartford. Us skaters, we want to see Skate Heaven become a reality. It's our dream. I'm here today to support the Hartford Skate Heaven project and see it continued. So let's have an open dialogue with things that matter and make sense in order to increase the level of corporate interest and involvement in our city. Let's invest in Hartford's youth. Hartford, like as a city, needs this. Thank you.
Well, there were three back there. We'll jump back here. So, once you
make a big statement, Tom.
Yeah, I will make. Thank you for your comments. My 16-year-old son is an avid skater. I've spent many hours at skate parks, and I understand.
We'll back.
Thank you for your presentation. At the last presentation you gave, I asked two questions, or several questions, one of which was, if we could bond like West Hartford bonded for Blueback Square, where would the designers suggest the most likely bondable project? Where would it be sited? What would it be? So I do want to have that included in the presentation finally. And then secondarily, where would the consultants recommend dormitories? The only way any of this is going to work out is if we have dormitories downtown. You know, I advocate for those right across the highway near Selvin Shoes, develop that whole area. We've seen what Trinity is is done with having a company come in and build the dormitories for them. So again, I hope your final presentation includes where would you site dormitories. I don't think UConn's going to end up where it is, quite honestly. I'm very hopeful it will end up elsewhere, right across the highway. If it doesn't, let's plan for future dormitories for another university or another scenario, maybe UConn expanding. Thank you.
And there was someone in front. Chris, I guess.
I didn't see it in the presentation, so I'm asking, but it may be redundant, was covered at another meeting. What's the mix of market and below market plan, or is this project feasible with below market?
The city's basic goal is 80-20. We haven't thought to that extent at this point. This was just a massing and scale analysis. This wasn't a financing or figuring out what the market mix would be.
To clarify, so the projections, though, is that all at market, or?
There is no definition of market or affordable, but we our goal is 80-20, and there's a clear understanding on the city's part that we need affordability downtown just as well as we need it everywhere else. So we will be looking for developments to do 80-20, and I will say that development that went before the council, was it just this week? It was just this week for approval. The council amended the agreement to include an 80-20, make it an 80-20 deal. So there is a direction that's coming from the council, so that will be the most likely mix that we'll see. 80% okay. Market, 20% affordable.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just had a question. I'm not sure if you guys are aware that they're actually currently constructing the skate park right now.
I know that.
At that site. So, and I know... which has been a five-year endeavor to get going, and I want to thank everyone here who showed up today to support that park, because it wouldn't have happened without them. But my question is, you're saying that we could have this green public square and have the skate park as well.
Yes.
But how do you propose to move a poured-in-place concrete park?
I'll let him describe that.
Well, it would have to be phased, so that you know, this requires some substantial infrastructural changes to make the grading work the way it does now. So we'd have to work with this community to figure out how that gets phased over time. But resources would come to this park to allow, as Scott said, the square footage of the park we're envisioning is actually larger than the one that's being installed now. So like anything else, there would be maybe a temporary location to do the construction to then build a permanent one. But we'd have to work with this community to figure out how that was actually done, like anything else in the city.
So the $160,000 that's going into the park that's being constructed currently right now,
right.
You're saying it would be torn down?
No, we're not saying that at all. We work around it. You work around what you
right,
have.
That's right.
You keep what you have and work around it and continue to expand and grow. So there's potential to change. And that's one of the things that they're saying, that we'd keep what's there, we'd work around it and do other things.
And the building with all the beautiful artwork up on it right now, you're saying knock those down?
Well, there's a vision, there's not a design yet for the park. There would be a whole community
public process
for that park.
Okay. So, Tim, let's work back and around this way. So there's Chris Brown right there. No, turn behind you. And then go back to Kelly and keep working your way around the room.
So I heard something about bonding, and I know it meant money, but I think it's really important to see the bond that has grown and the scene, the art and skateboarding and active scene that has grown up without any input from outside right here in Hartford, and we need to support that and make it grow even more. I know the amount of money that they've been building the skate park over the last 5 years is less than the target, and I think one of the efforts would be to funnel more money toward completing that design and expanding on it. And I think another thing, and I'm sort of astounded that I didn't think of this till now, after all the years that these meetings have been going to, is that I think a business that should be really encouraged to develop here in Hartford is design firms. It would help create jobs, and then people who live in Hartford could show us how to design things for Hartford by people who live in Hartford. It would provide jobs. People would not misidentify streets and bridges and their slides. It would be fantastic. And I think what has constantly caused a lot of problems here is people who don't live here imposing their ideas on the city. And it's done a half a century or more of damage to the fabric of our city. And we need to repair that. And I'm glad that these young people here have helped stitch it back together through their own hard work and effort and art and activity. So thank you.
So let's go. So let's go to, back to Kelly and across the room here.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I came here tonight because I represent, I'm the co-chair of the Clay Arsenal NRZ, which borderlines with this Downtown North project. That being said, we haven't talked a lot about, because of the different slides, very upset with you, you didn't include my little section in it. But however, I just want everybody to know here, through a lot of work, through a lot of energy, Tom Deller, Wayne Benjamin, and those guys helped us out in developing a strategy with this Downtown North to come into the neighborhoods, to reach further, not just stopping at lot B12, but going further down. And I wanted to say to Mr. Deller that maybe, you know, this skate park here, you did a great job with me. You addressed some of the concerns that maybe we will have some dorms coming soon. It could be a high possibility. However, the skate park seems to be a very interesting thing. A lot of folks here for it. I don't know what you guys have planned in store, but I hope as you work with me in my community, maybe we can work with them in
Absolutely.
Your community.
Yeah.
All right, but I just want to say thank you. Job well done on my behalf, because we got, you did a great job for Clay Arsenal.
Thank you. Just one comment that this is our third public meeting. The first one, I think 8 people came. The second one, maybe 30. This one, a huge number. New groups come to every one, and that's got to keep moving forward, you know, where this is going to be, this will be the best possible plan if everybody with an interest makes their voices heard. That's the key thing. So
Tim, can you come up here and then back there and then there?
Here? Yeah.
So the I-84 viaduct is ending the span of viability, and they have the I-84 project to redesign. Is there any consideration taken into account to kind of, with that redevelopment, to maybe recapture some public space above I-84 like you have with the skate park, to try to draw pedestrians from the north, from the downtown to the north end, and try to make it more walkable and pedestrian friendly?
2 or 3 years ago, a report was done, I believe it was titled The Hub of Hartford, that talked about how to take 84 down and make it more of a, call it a boulevard, an urban boulevard. Connecticut DOT has started the process. There's a public advisory group that meets, I think it's every 2 months. We meet with them in the development services office monthly to go over where they are and what they're doing, the things that they're thinking about. We're right now defining I guess it's the public benefit statement. I'm getting the words wrong. I don't remember exactly what it is, but there's a statement that you have to have about what you're trying to achieve as you do the analysis. And there's been a series of meetings because the neighborhood groups that are involved are not happy with what Connecticut DOT has drafted. So we're trying to revise it and refine it, and there'll be a series of meetings coming up. But this is it's a 15-year timeline. We're in year one. So it's a billion-dollar project, and so it's going to take a while. So over here to David, and then someone in the back. I'm working my way around. I'll try to get to you before we run out of time.
Dave Panagor, Hartford resident now. A couple things. One is, the skate park, it was a heck of a fight to get it funded, and it needs to stay, period.